Hold your head up high and don't be afraid of the dark. At the end of the storm, there's a golden sky and sweet to the song of the lark.
When you walk through a storm, hold your head up high and don't be afraid of the dark.
At the end of the storm, there's a golden sky and a sweet silver song of the lark.
Walk on through the wind, walk on through the rain, though your dreams be tossed and blown. Walk on, walk on, walk on with hope in your heart, and you'll and don't be afraid of the dark.
At the end of the storm, there's a golden sky and sweet silver song of the lark.
Walk on,
walk on
the wind.
Through the wind,
walk on,
walk on
through the rain,
through the rain,
though your dreams be tossed and blown. Walk on,
walk on,
walk on with hope in your heart, and you'll
never walk alone.
A Happy Man by Edwin Arlington Robinson. When these graven lines you see, traveller, do not pity me. Though I be among the dead, let no mournful word be said. Daughters that I leave behind, and their children, all were kind. Near to them and to my wife, I was happy all my life. My two daughters I married right, and their children I rocked at night. Death nor sorrow never brought cause for one unhappy thought. Now, and with no need for tears, here they leave me full of years. Leave me to my quiet rest in the region of the blessed. Well, good afternoon. So lovely to see you here, and welcome to the celebration of Captain Sir Tom Moore's life. Well, goodness me, what an entrance. The song we've just listened to, You'll Never Walk Alone, what a perfect start to today's service. And really, to hear Tom's voice is so lovely, isn't it? A wonderful beginning, and particularly special as Tom, with the help of his grandson Benji, chose the music for today. I would like to take this opportunity to thank you very, very much. Thank you so much for all the hard work and effort that you've put into making today's service so special. Thank you very much for sharing him with the world for the last year. And thank you so, so much for the huge honor of being part of today's service. I have invited you to a celebration, haven't I? And understandably, that word must seem empty, must seem hollow on a day like today. But hidden in all the pain and sorrow that you feel, there is undeniably so much to celebrate. You can celebrate the fact that Tom has been a part of your life. And though he is no longer with us, you can celebrate that you were privileged and honored to have known him. Tom served in India and the Burma campaign during the Second World War, and later became an instructor in armored warfare. Being ever adventurous, one of his lifelong passions was motorbikes, and this was apparently a bit of a family pursuit, wasn't it? Which he continued throughout his life. Riding stopped, but the passion remained until the end. After the war ended, he worked as managing director of a concrete company. He was an incredible engineer, with an ever-inquiring and curious mind, always looking to build bigger, better, faster. And maybe it was having daughters that Tom was such a staunch believer in the ability of women to excel in the field of engineering if given the opportunity, something the foundation is promoting. Lao Tzu, author of the Tao Te Ching, once said that a journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step, a beautiful Chinese proverb. Captain Tom's journey of 100 laps began last spring with the aim of raising £1,000 in aid of NHS charities by his 100th birthday. Who would have thought that by his birthday, nearly £40 million, making him a Guinness World Record-breaking fundraiser, with donations from 1.5 million supporters, would be raised? Quite incredible. This triggered the creation of the foundation in his name. He was so, so proud of the cornerstones of the foundation that he created. And he was so proud that the cornerstones are about tackling the causes of loneliness, education, and inequality. It's quite incredible to think that 163 countries donated. That's nearly the whole world. As wonderful as we think our NHS is, people from other countries really aren't going to be interested in our health. So it seems obvious to me that they were really investing in Captain Tom and the values that he stood for. He was a proud British veteran and a gentleman. He lived in a multi-generational environment. Not only would that have kept him young, but also symbolizes the importance of family to him. What sacrifices did he and his peers make in defense of our freedom? A man with a strong moral compass, a strong work ethic, a sense of pride, and an indomitable spirit. He serves as an inspiration to us all to never give up and remain strong, though knowing that tomorrow will be a better day. But let's not also forget that he was just a little bit of a charmer, with a wonderful sense of humour and a delightfully boyish sense of mischief. When asked what he wanted in his dressing room for an interview with Piers Morgan, his lightning response was for a bottle of Coke, dairy milk chocolate, and six blondes. Our very own Tom Bond. They really don't make them like that anymore, do they? Almost overnight, Tom was propelled into international notoriety, receiving many accolades and the love of people all over the world, recording a number one chart-topping single, and he was appointed as honorary colonel of the Army Foundation College. On the 17th of July, 2020, he was personally knighted by the Queen at Windsor Castle. I know that Tom was so proud of his military achievements and everything that has transpired in the last year. But I think that he would count among his greatest achievements becoming a dad and a granddad. He was so, so proud of you all, and I am very much looking forward to hearing your tribute shortly. You know, today is a day of memories. Today we come together to remember and to honour a hard-working, charming, kind, playful, and much-loved gentleman. To his daughters, to his grandchildren, sons-in-law and family, he leaves behind him an enduring love. To all those lucky enough to have known him, he leaves the comfort of true friendship. And when you're missing him, he leaves behind the joy of catching glimpses of him in the gestures, expressions, and later than today, the laughter of Lucy, Hannah, Titi, Max, Benji, and Georgia. The world is undoubtedly a much poorer place without him in it, but I know that you'll agree with me when I say that you are so much richer for having known and for having loved him. We're now going to have a little bit of a musical tribute, The White Cliffs of Dover, performed by Dame Vera Lynn.
There'll be bluebirds over the white cliffs of Dover tomorrow. Just you wait and see. The shepherd will tend his sheep, the valley will bloom again, and Jimmy will go to sleep in his own little room again. There'll be bluebirds over the white cliffs of Dover tomorrow. Just you wait and see.
Absolutely lovely. I hope you enjoyed listening to that. And wonderful, wonderful lyrics. Very appropriate for today. I'd now like to invite up Lucy, if I may, and she's going to give her tribute to her father.
Daddy, you would always tell us, best foot forward. And true to your word, that's just what you did last year, raising a fortune for the NHS and walking your way into the nation's hearts. In some ways, we wondered, who would have thought it? Yet, knowing you as we did, your motivation and inspiration was no surprise. I remember how in Cambridgeshire you became a master of the land. You loved it, and we spent hours together working machinery, planting fruit trees, growing veg, and mowing the grass. You taught us to be practical, and your presence were too. We have a treasure chest of tools because of you. On my wedding day, you were a steadying influence. I felt jittery and asked you to tell me a calming story. You squeezed my hand tight and talked to me about concrete pipes. And there's a bittersweet day remembered with Tom and Max. We visited the tank museum, saw the tank you fought in, and you told us stories of how it had been for you. But it was the same day Pamela, our mother, died. We often talked about milestones in your life, and we laughed about the possibility of you reaching of 100 years. You said, it's just a number. I don't feel any different. And right to the end, you ignored the number and kept on going, urging us all to do the same with your mantra, tomorrow will be a good day. You have always influenced me with your strength, your energy, your drive to get out of bed with a spring in your step and a purpose in mind. I know you will be watching us chuckling, saying, don't be too sad, as something has to get you in the end. Daddy, I am so proud of you. What you achieved, your whole life, and especially in the last year. You may be gone, but your message and your spirit lives on.
Thank you so very, very much, Lucy. What a lovely and beautiful, heartfelt tribute that was. Titi is now going to read a poem by Edwin Waugh entitled, Oh, the Wild, Wild Moors.
I would like to dedicate this to my granddad, who loved and grew up in the Yorkshire Dales. My heart's away in the lonely hills, where I would gladly be, on a rolling ridge or blackstone edge, where the wild wind whistles free. There often careless youth I roved, when summer days were fine, and the meanest flower of the heathery waste delights this heart of mine. Oh, the lonely moors, the breezy moors, the stormy hills so free. Oh, the wild, wild moors, the wild, wild moors, the sweet wild moors for me. I fain would stroll on lofty knoll and rural moor again, or the wildly stray one long bright day in Turvin's bonny glen. The thought of Wardle's breezy height fills all my heart with glee, and a distant view of the hills so blue brings tears into my ee. Oh, the lonely moors, the breezy moors, the stormy hills so free. Oh, the wild, wild moors, the wild, wild moors, the sweet wild moors for me. Oh, blessed sleep that brings in dreams my native hills to me, the heathery wilds, the rushing streams where once I wandered free. 'Tis a glimpse of life's sweet morning light, a bright angelic ray that steals into the dusky night and fades with waking day. Oh, the lonely moors, the breezy moors, the stormy hills so free. Oh, the wild, wild moors, the wild, wild moors, the sweet wild moors for me.
Thank you very, very much, T.T. What an exquisite poem you've chosen. Beautifully read. You're obviously a natural orator. We're now going to take a moment to listen to the lovely voice of Alfie Beau. I vow to thee, my country.
The will for life. I think this phrase typifies your attitude to life every day. The ability to get out of bed every morning with an invested purpose is something we all look to achieve. If there is a lesson I have learned from living with you these past 13 years, it's the power of positivity and kindness. I truly do not believe I'd be the person I am today without your sound guidance. Our chats mid-afternoon that were only meant to last a few minutes quickly turned into hour-long conversations, delving into so many thought-provoking avenues. These are memories that I will never forget and are ones I'm incredibly grateful to have. I can't imagine how many pieces of my sport equipment would have stayed broken without your ever-trusting superglue. Quite often, after cricket matches, there'd be some issue with my helmet or bat in which you never ceased to offer assistance in fixing. I suppose the tables turned in the latter years, where often it would be Georgia or me fixing something on your phone. The motivation you gave me for every sports fixture, knowing however many wickets I took, tries I scored, often had a £1 cash reward at the end. This was certainly something I took with me into every game. Coming home soaked in mud or sweating from the sun, the first words I ever heard were, "Did you win, and how did you play?" If it hadn't gone to plan, there was never a negative word. It was only how to improve next time. I think in many ways, those are the moments that will stay with me the most. The five words we both dreaded the most every night were, "You're the last one up," in turn, meaning we had to put the alarm on. Whoever it was often had the gentle roll of the eyes, partially out of embarrassment of realizing we were the last up, and partly because we had the responsibility of the alarm. Growing up with you every day, the smell of porridge as I came downstairs was almost a sign to know everything was okay. A few minutes later, seeing the plate slide down the side of the chair at the perfect height for the dogs to lick the remains was something that filled the morning with more than a bit of joy. In recent weeks since your passing, I've sat in the room where I work. The window overlooks onto our garden, where I can still see a 7-year-old version of myself sitting on your lap with my hands on the steering wheel, trying to drive. Whilst of course I could not touch the pedals, you brought the experience to life, making me feel as if I could drive anywhere and could do anything. Looking to where I am now, there is a piece of you in everything I do. Whether it's the motivation for sport or even in my school life. For example, taking design and technology at A-level, I am almost certain sitting in Grandad's fix-it shop with you tinkering away sparked an interest in me to do the same. As a grandson-grandfather relationship, we were always very close, yet this adventure we've been on as a family this last year has only made us closer. Sitting behind the camera or next to you in almost all of your hundreds of interviews, the laughs we had as the camera would fall off the stand or one of us made a mistake in the recordings. Standing in a sea of birthday cards sent to you was something I still cannot fathom. Going home and showing the pictures, I could see your eyes light up in gratitude and pride. The places we got to go and the things we got to see together, I know filled your heart with joy to know that we did it as a family. I could not have asked for a better last year to spend with you. I cannot thank you enough for everything you've done for me. You've been the most incredible grandfather, mentor, and most importantly, a friend. I will do everything I can to live up to the standards you have set and promise to continue the incredible legacy you have left.
The Magician by Melissa Ormiston and Georgia Ingram Moore. We live with the magician. He makes us laugh all day. He knows what is important and what I really want to say. He's been beside me my whole life, seen every up and down. He lights the room with his quips. You'll never see him frown. There's his sorcery in the garden, his clever quietening of our dogs. The tomato plants he made spring up, his workshop full of cogs. He eats porridge every morning and sips cocoa every night. He loves to go for walks outside in the morning when it's bright. We live with a magician. He makes things disappear like any worries that I had at the start of a school year. He makes masterpieces out of paper and stamps and string and glue. When dragons chased us in our games, he knew just what to do. He tells stories of his loved ones, the people left behind. He doesn't cry or moan or shout. He just says, best be kind. We cook together all the time, casseroles, roasts and stews, cakes and biscuits, sweets and shakes. They're our favorite too. We live with a magician. He's taught me lots of tricks, like where to hide chocolate piled up like tons of bricks. He finds happiness in everything, smiles each and every day. He says the key to life is to keep sad thoughts at bay. He doesn't mind if things are odd, like the objects in my pocket. He said only the best people carry spiders and tiny sprockets. Even when things are tough, he's taught us to be brave. He said there's always light in the deepest, darkest caves. He likes to tell us stories of daring things he's done. He's climbed mountains, ridden motorbikes. He says, yes, life's been fun. Is it difficult to be happy every single day? The magician shakes his head and smiles, not since I came to stay. Although we know that life moves fast, we need to stop and stare at joyful things around us because they're hidden everywhere. When we are together, he makes me feel so tall. He says I can be what I like. What? Anything at all? Can I become an astronaut, blue whale, or giant mouse? Why not, he says. Why, we'll just make sure to get a bigger house. He tells me almost every day, be honest and be true, to put your best foot forward and see yourself in other shoes. He's taught me tons over the years, and he says that we've taught him. He said his glass is filled with love, right up to the brim. We live with the magician. He makes things disappear. His final act was really smart. He left, but he's still here.
Well, goodness me. What an amazing family you are. Absolutely incredible. Thank you so much, Benji and Georgia, for your lovely words. And you know, your granddad would be so, so proud of you all. You know, poetry in our lives is so important. Our English language is so rich, so potent. And when you take out the extraneous, unnecessary words, you're left with a rich perfume of meaning and feeling. If you can find the right poem, if you can find that there's just one other person who feels the same way that you do but expresses it so beautifully, then that really helps. When you take beautiful poetry and you add music to it, something truly magical happens. We are now in for a very, very special treat indeed. We're about to hear a song originally composed by Charlie Chaplin, who was apparently inspired by Puccini's Tosca. John Turner and Jeffrey Parsons added the lyrics and title in 1954. In the lyrics, based on lines and themes from one of Chaplin's films apparently, the singer is telling the listener to cheer up and that there will always be a bright tomorrow, just as long as they smile. Michael Bublé has kindly recorded this in honor of Captain Tom and for you all. Smile, performed by Michael Bublé.
Smile. Though your heart is aching, smile even though it's breaking. When there are clouds in the sky, you'll get by if you smile through your fears and sorrow. Smile, and maybe tomorrow you'll see the sun come shining through for you. Light up your face with gladness, hide every trace of sadness, although a tear may be ever so near. That's the time you must keep on trying. Smile, what's the use of crying? You'll find that life is still worthwhile if you just smile.
We could not have asked for a more magical childhood. We felt so loved and so safe. We had the happiness of a stable family life, peppered with the excitement of intrepid camping trips across Europe, which gave our young minds a window on the world that you said was our oyster to open. We had always been close, but we became even closer as we all came to terms with our mother's death. A few months later, when Colin and I planned to move to a new home, it felt totally wrong to leave you on your own. We urged you to move in with us. We were so happy when you agreed. Our family of three became four as we walked through the door of our new home, two different lives now merging. Soon, our four became five when Georgia was born, and we embarked on the most amazing multi-generational life journey, thriving on the wealth of knowledge that you brought and the knowledge we in turn gave to you. You delighted in Benji and Georgia, and when Benji started school, you were totally engaged in his new venture. You spent hours with Georgia, the youngest grandchild by far. She sat on your lap as you cut and glued and stamped and read together. Where's Georgia, I would ask. With Grandpa, of course. Your relationship with them was a constant reminder of how lucky we were to have you as a father and of that special bond we have. You flourished at home and became so busy. We built you a big workshop and put the sign on the door, Granddad's Fix-It Shop. You spent hours and hours tinkering away up there with our dogs playing at your feet. You insisted we install wood burners in our living rooms, and you chopped the wood and managed the fires with sheer delight. You managed the mowing, the dogs, the bins, the greenhouse, and lunch every Sunday. The children would come in muddy or dusty and exhausted from sport, and a magnificent roast lunch would await them. We all had our roles. You became the solid foundation, creating a slightly different relationship with each one of us. You took such pleasure in declaring that you and Colin should be given a Guinness World Record for the length of time a Yorkshireman and a Welshman lived together in total harmony. You interchanged the Union, English, and Welsh flags on the flagpole that you insisted on installing. You should know that Benji and Georgia are responsible for the flags now, and the Union flag is laying at half-mast for you. We know, because you told everyone who would listen, that you relished this next phase of your life. We respected your independence, your values, and your space, and you did the same for us. We felt your love, and we know that you felt our love for you. We took such pleasure in our routines with you, like Benji and Georgia taking it in turns to go and nudge you awake for dinner. I wasn't asleep, you would declare with some indignation. We would all smile, enjoying this familiar, funny, and enchanting denial. In the latter years, as you got older, we got used to the soft shuffle and scrape of your frame as resiliently you made your way from your living room to the kitchen, sneaking a treat to the dogs as you passed. In all our musings and discussions, we never, ever imagined what the last year of your life would be like. Who would have thought our little family gesture would become what it did? The first humble goal of £100 that quickly became 1,000, believing that would be tough enough. We just couldn't believe it, could we? When it reached £38.9 million, We are so proud of the way you handled everything that happened. We had been so close as a family before this, but we were thrust even closer together as the world became enthralled by your spirit of hope, positivity, and resilience. They too saw your belief in kindness and the fundamental goodness of the human spirit. As your hearing loss made interviews a little tricky, I willingly became your ears. As we sat shoulder to shoulder, we had so many moments of utter joy and laughter as we prepared for each and every interview. Colin, Benji, and Georgia watching with amazement as they saw you on every TV channel and on the front page of almost every paper. You are not a man in the habit of expressing your inner feelings, but this time together evoked an honesty between us that felt as magical as you becoming a beacon of light and hope to the world. You are the fabric of our lives and home, every cupboard that we open, each door that we go through, you are there. We have lost a huge part of our family. Our five now stands as four. We feel your loss with the deafening silence. Those years of habits are so hard to break. I come down the staircase in the morning, and forgetting for a moment, I look left to check if your bedroom lights are on and if I can hear you moving around. And then I remember, you're not there. The loss of you is a dull physical ache for me, but the power of the love you left us with allows us to stay strong. In the last days and hours we had together, you talked with pride about the lasting legacy of hope people said you had created, brought to life with the foundation in your name. You declared to me and the nursing staff that you had a lot more fundraising in you and you would be back as soon as you felt better. We are also proud of everything you have achieved and promise to keep your legacy alive. Thank you for all the special times we've shared. Our relationship cannot be broken by death. You will be with me always.
Hannah, thank you so, so much. Again, an absolutely beautiful tribute. Really lovely, thank you. Of course, you all know how lucky you are to have had such a special man in your life. But I also think he would be the first to say how lucky he was to have had you all in his. A full and a happy life. You know, what is a life well lived? If we are lucky enough to live a long and fairly good life and look back, the questions we're going to ask ourselves will rarely be to do with material things. You know, we spend so much time mithering about so many things that we suddenly realize on days like today are really insignificant and meaningless. But in Captain Tom's case, the financial legacy that he leaves us is, of course, extremely important. But it's what can be done with that legacy that really matters. Do you not think that a truly successful life is measured by the difference that we can make in the world? What we do for our family, what we do for our friends, what we do for our community. And Captain Tom epitomizes this. To coin the foundation's motto, his lasting legacy is inspiring hope where it's needed most. And he certainly did that. There is a wonderful writer, philosopher, and poet of the 19th century called Ralph Waldo Emerson. I don't know if you've heard of him. He was an amazing advocate of social reform, and his indomitable spirit and faith in humanity reminds me a little of Tom. He gave a definition of success, which I would like to share with you, if I may. He said, to laugh often and much, to win the respect of intelligent people and the affection of children, to appreciate beauty, To find the best in others, to leave the world a little bit better, whether by a healthy child, a garden patch, or kindness to others. To know that even one life has breathed easier because you have lived, this is to have succeeded. When you feel sad, try and remember that grief is the price that we pay for loving. And you know, the only reason that you hurt is because you have had the privilege of loving so very much. Tom was central to his family. He lived a life surrounded by the love of his family, the love of his friends, and in the last year becoming a darling not only of the nation but of the world, and a beacon of hope during these challenging times. His was truly a rich and successful life indeed. Goethe said, "Whatever you can do or dream you can, begin it. Boldness has genius, power, and magic in it." Please, could I now ask you all to stand for the committal? To everything there is a season and a time to every purpose on earth. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to weep and a time to dance. A time to get and a time to lose. Here in this last act, immune now to the changes and the chances of our mortal lot, we commit the body of Captain Sir Tom Moore to its natural end. Be sad that he has gone, but happy that he has lived and will remain in our hearts forever. Remember Me by Margaret Mead. I cannot be seen, but I can be remembered. So as you stand upon a shore, gazing at a beautiful sea, remember me. As you look in awe at a mighty forest and its grand majesty, remember me. As you look upon a flower and admire its simplicity, remember me. Remember me in your heart and your thoughts of the times that we've loved, the times that we've cried, and the times that we've laughed. For if you always think of me, I will have never gone. Well, sadly, we are coming towards the end of the service now. Once again, I would like to thank you so much, and indeed everyone involved, for all the hard work and effort that has gone into making today's service so, so special. And I think Tom would thoroughly approve, don't you? I'm going to, in a moment, hand over to Colonel Tim Exton, commanding officer of the Yorkshire Regiment, for the remembrance. And after that, I'm going to hand you back into the care of our funeral director, Gerald, from Neville Funerals. But finally, we are going to listen to Tom's last choice of song. The lyrics are very, very appropriate and perfect for today, because I think, in a way, we are giving Tom the final word. My Way, performed by Frank Sinatra.
And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full, I traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Regrets I've had a few, but then again too few to mention. I did what I had to do, saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was dark, share of losing, and now as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way, oh no. No, not me, I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say the things he truly.
Please, will you stand?
They shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them. When you go home, tell them of us and say, for your tomorrow, we gave our today.
Thank you.